You're looking at a live picture of what is perhaps the most controversial rock concert tour in history. The Jackson Victory Tour, opening tonight in Kansas City.
Okay.
Good evening, I'm Ted Koppel, and this is Nightline. The show is on, the tour has begun, but the controversy continues over ticket sales and booking arrangements and the way promoters of the Jackson Tour are handling them. We'll take you to tonight's concert as it's happening. We'll focus on the controversy and the phenomenon as we talk live, among others, with Michael Jackson's brother, Jackie Jackson.
This is ABC News Nightline. Reporting from Washington, Ted Koppel.
When the Rolling Stones toured the U.S. back in 1981, they made more money than any concert tour before or since, grossing $34 million. Estimates for the Jackson's Victory Tour range from a low of $60 million to a projected high of $100 million. When David Bowie toured last summer, he traveled with 45 tons of equipment, filling six semi-trailers. The Jacksons are traveling with 375 tons aboard 22 semis. Hotel costs alone, up to $1 million. Stadium costs, over $1 million. This tour, as Judd Rose tells us now, is the one by which all future rock tours will be measured.
This is the zoo at 637. Everything's up to date in Kansas City, and everybody's very excited. That's tonight. Who would have thought 4 weeks ago they were even going to be coming to Kansas City?
Who would have thought 4 weeks ago they would have even been performing anywhere? But finally, they are, and today, the Jacksons and Kansas City fit together like a hand in glove.
Oh, I saw Michael Jackson! I saw Michael Jackson!
Yeah, I saw it! Yeah, I saw it!
Right.
He's gorgeous!
What do you look like?
Good!
We're so happy to be a part of this. This means very much to us. We want everyone to see the show.
And it's the show it seems everyone wants to see. It starts tonight in Kansas City, and from here, continues on to at least 10 more cities, complete with its custom-made stage, 5 stories high, 60 feet long, 90 feet deep. It's the Victory Tour, perhaps the biggest in entertainment history.
It's bigger than the Beatles, it's bigger than Presley, it's bigger than anything.
And it happens here at the Truman Sports Complex. Now, Harry Truman coined the phrase, the buck stops here, but for the Jacksons, the bucks start here, $50, $60, maybe $100 million before it's over. And this may not just be where the tour starts, but where the turmoil ends. It began a year ago when the anniversary of Motown Records brought together the Jacksons and brought down the house. That led to a news conference announcing the tour, a reunion for superstar Michael Jackson and his singing siblings. Backing the concerts, boxing promoter Don King, who paid $3 million, and Pepsi-Cola, which fronted another $5.5 million. But the fizz faded fast. Months passed with nothing to show but ugly headlines documenting a tangled web of battling egos and fights over money and power involving agents, lawyers, and the promoter. At Michael Jackson's behest, Don King was demoted and a new promoter sought, and with weeks to go, the owner of the New England Patriots guaranteed almost $40 million and took on
the logistical equivalent of trying to do 12 to 14 Super Bowls in 5 weeks.
And everyone wanted a piece of the big game. Washington wanted it. Washington, D.C. wanted it.
So when you begin your greatly awaited cross-country tour, will you please be sure to stop off here in the nation's capital?
Even Wahoo wanted it.
Would you girls like to see Michael Jackson come to Wahoo?
Yes.
But if the Jacksons were needed in Nebraska, they were banned in Boston, or the next closest thing.
The motion is for denial.
Foxborough, Massachusetts voted to keep the Jacksons out, fearing massive crowds, traffic, and vandalism. Ironically, that kept the tour out of the stadium owned by promoter Chuck Sullivan. He was embarrassed, and the fans were outraged.
I think there's a ripoff involved here, sure. And people have sensed it. I think there's been a lack of class.
Many of Ron Chapman's Dallas listeners agreed, calling in to condemn the Jacksons' controversial ticket system, sending in a $120 money order for four tickets, no choice of date or seat, and no guarantee.
Suppose you just had, it was just one person wanted to go, and then you had to order four, I think that's stupid.
And if you didn't get tickets, you get a refund in 4 to 6 weeks.
Ordered tickets, paid $120, can't get them. They just won't show up.
If anybody was hurt, it wasn't done intentionally. It was only done in good faith. We wanted to give everybody an equal, fair chance to see the Jacksons on stage.
But many didn't take it that way. By early this week, less than half the 130,000 seats available for the Dallas concerts had been sold. There was talk of fan backlash, and the system was junked.
I've asked our promoter to end the mail order ticket system as soon as possible, so that no one would pay money unless they get a ticket.
Equally outrageous to many, charges the promoters were trying to muscle unprecedented concessions from stadiums like the Cotton Bowl, which rejected a suggestion of free rent.
We will never give away our stadium.
And when promoter Sullivan suggested free rental to the New Orleans Superdome, officials there turned their backs too.
We even asked him somewhat facetiously at one time to try to show us a way that we could make a dollar, and he laughed somewhat and said that maybe not be possible.
We've had auditoriums and hotels offer us free things, yes, because they wanted us to stay in the hotel for their publicity. But we've never tried to negotiate, say we want this free, we want that free, because that's not the way we do business.
It's hurt Michael Jackson already. Because of the way this thing has been organized, his basic humanistic appeal has been eroded. He's got to prove himself again.
I want you to know that I've decided to donate all my money I make from the performance to charity.
That's one way Michael Jackson hopes to repair his tarnished glitter, but the best way is what he and his brothers offer on stage. Tonight, it comes down to the stage. Here, the Jacksons can best silence their critics, offering them the thrill of victory and avoiding the agony of defeat. Judd Rose for Nightline in Kansas City.
When we come back, we'll hear two sides of the controversy over the Jackson tour. We'll talk live, with the tour's national promoter, Chuck Sullivan, and with the general manager of the New Orleans Superdome, Cliff Wallace, and more of tonight's concert.
This is ABC News Nightline, brought to you by Kraft.
Sure, a little bit later in this broadcast, but joining us live now from Arrowhead Stadium in Kansas City is Chuck Sullivan, national tour promoter for the Jackson Victory Tour. And from our affiliate WVUE in New Orleans, Cliff Wallace, general manager of the New Orleans Superdome and president-elect of the International Association of Auditorium Managers, the people that tour promoters have to deal with when they want to book a concert into a stadium or concert hall. Chuck Sullivan, are you a bad guy or just a fellow trying to make a buck?
I don't think I'm a bad guy. What we're trying to present here, Ted, is a series of concerts, and tonight has been so spectacular, it's like a touchdown a minute in the Arrowhead Stadium.
It has been said that you had to guarantee something in the neighborhood of $40 million up front, and it would be logical, I guess, then to assume that you got to do some pretty tough business making to get all that money back. Are those figures just totally out of line, or are we pretty much in the ballpark?
Those figures aren't too far out of line, but I think the controversy over tickets and stadium deals is over. I went through the press box just a few minutes ago, and the press is so excited about this show that all of that's behind us. Everybody's interested in the lasers and the creative special effects, Kreton monsters on the stage, smoke bombs, all sorts of exciting things. That's all behind us now, Ted, and people just are looking at this thing like the most exciting thing that's ever happened since the Beatles tour.
Well, I suspect from Kansas City and especially from Arrowhead Stadium that it's a little hard to focus on what the rest of the world is thinking about. You got to remember, there are a few hundred million of us out there who are not at the concert. One of them who's not there is Cliff Wallace. Cliff, is it all behind them? Is the controversy over?
Well, I don't think it is, Ted. I think the controversy has been so serious the last few weeks that it's going to take a while for it to get over. But I'm happy to see some changes that have been made in the last few days that certainly correct some of the tragic mistakes I think were made some weeks ago when Mr. Sullivan came on the scene.
What, in fact, was it? I mean, you referred to them as tragic mistakes. Nobody was doing anything illegal or fattening, were they?
No, I don't think so. I think there were mistakes made with regard to trying to negotiate the deals with the stadiums. There was pressure put on us, unprecedented pressure, unlike any pressures that I've ever seen in some 20 years in this business. And we also saw a ticket campaign, a national ticket campaign, that really had, it was total disregard for the public. But that has been changed, and we're delighted to see that.
In point of fact now, Chuck Sullivan, what has to happen to all those people who are watching tonight in other cities and saying, oh boy, I hope they come our way? How do people get tickets? First come, first served, one apiece, two apiece, 10 apiece?
The ticket policy, Ted, will be established on a local basis in each city where we play. In some cases, it may be through a computer ticket system, in some cases over the counter at the stadium, and in some cases on a local mail order basis. Each ticket policy will be established locally. But I went through the crowd early tonight, and I talked with over 100 fans, and none of them were complaining about the ticket policy. They were elated to be here, and they were elated to be a part of this wonderful spectacle of American music, because the big difference between this and the Beatles is the Jacksons are American. And what they're presenting here is the very best American music has to offer. And my family is proud to be a part of that.
Let me focus for one more minute, and we're going to be getting away from this in another couple of minutes. You'll be relieved to know. How much do you have to earn before you start making some money? In other words, how much does this concert have to gross before Chuck Sullivan starts putting anything away?
Ted, I don't even know the exact numbers.
Rough ballpark figure will do just fine.
I think that the expenses of this production are so significant that at this point in time, it's really too early to judge. We're just hoping that we break even and we give America some fun this summer.
Cliff Wallace, when you talk about unreasonable demands, is there such a thing in this game? I mean, if the Jackson family is so extraordinarily popular, why shouldn't they make any demands that they want? Why shouldn't their promoters make any demands that they want?
Ted, I think the unreasonable demands really can be equated to those demands associated with asking our facilities to effectively subsidize this tour. And when the Jacksons are so popular that they can demand $30 a ticket, which they may be able to demand and probably are going to show that they can demand it, they're grossing $4 to $5 million in each city. We can't expect the taxpayers to subsidize that tour and pay deficit operations in addition to paying for these public facilities. So the Jacksons must be expected to pay a reasonable and fair price for the public assembly facility, and a price that must be considered a normal cost of doing business in that respective city.
All right, gentlemen, we're going to take a break. We'll talk live with Michael Jackson's oldest brother, Jackie Jackson, when we return. Plus, we'll have more of tonight's concert.
Now the first time that I saw you walking down the street so pretty, going so fast. Now you say that I don't love you. I'm my love one.
In a moment, I'll be talking live with Jackie Jackson. But first, let's take a look at an excerpt from what has been, without question, the most anticipated entertainment event of this year, the concert that is now underway in Kansas City, the Jackson's Victory Tour, an excerpt from Michael Jackson's Off the Wall.
Listen. Do what you wanna do. There ain't no rule. Cause I do. It's time to come alive and a party on right through the light. You take that inhibition. I gotta let that fool is deep inside. Wanna see your next exhibition. Woo!
Michael Jackson tonight. His oldest brother Jackie wasn't able to perform in tonight's concert because he's recovering from knee surgery. Jackie Jackson is with us now live from his home in Encino, California. Jackie, why this tour? Tell us from the inside. We have a segment on this program that we call our Insider Report. You can help us with that one tonight. Why did the family decide to go ahead with this? Money?
No, because the fellows haven't toured in a long, long time, and because all the albums and all success of Michael and the brothers, people wanted to see us on tour. I think that we owe something to the people by going on tour, touring like this.
You and your brothers are all sensitive people, and you must know that there's been a lot of controversy over the pricing policy, the way the tickets were ordered. Did that come as a surprise to you? I mean, you've already done a lot to remedy that problem. But why did that come as a surprise to you, if at all? Why was that necessary?
Well, the ticket price and everything about the mail order and everything, I think it was for the safety of the people, for one thing. And I think the ticket prices weren't priced that high. To me, if the public would really take a look at the show, they can see that it's worth it.
Well,
every bit of it.
I mean, forgive me, I can understand when you're making a lot of money, then having to put out $120 may not seem like a lot, but when someone is earning $10,000 a year, $200 a week, or $300 a week, having to put out $120 is a lot of money, and having to be without it for 6 weeks. Did you not know that that was going to cause problems?
Not like it's causing now. I didn't know that. But we're trying to rectify that problem right now, and it's been taken care of.
Well, it certainly I mean, you know, Michael, for example, is giving away everything that he earns on this. Why did he go that far? Do you know? Did he agonize over that a long time?
Michael is he's a very, very giving person, and he likes doing things like that, and he's a very honest person. He's a lovable person, and I'm sure the brothers would give things away, too, the same way.
Well, I mean, what he is giving away is so extraordinary. I mean, his publicist was quoted as saying what he's giving away is more than I will earn in 5 lifetimes. There are some estimates that what he gives away may be up to $5 million. Does that sound right?
That's a lot of money. It sure is.
That is a lot of money.
That's a lot of money. He's like that, Ted, and he's a very giving person, like I said.
Now, what about Jackie Jackson? I don't want to let you go without you hurt your knee. Doing what? Dancing?
Dancing, and like I run about 10 miles every morning, and I work out a lot, and this is like a common accident, you know, for athletes. A lot of athletes catch this kind of accident. And what happened was they cut off part of the femur bone. And about this much of the femur bone they took out. So the doctor told me that it's going to take about 4 to 6 months to heal. And all of my spirits are very high right now, hoping that I can get back on the tour and be with the brothers.
Well, you know, the only thing it means, Jackie, is that if you can't, then next year we're going to have to do the whole thing all over again so you can go along with them.
I don't think I want to do this next year.
All right, listen, you're off. Yeah, go ahead. Say what you were going to say.
There's a lot of work involved. I had a lot of fun doing it, and just putting this tour together. It took us about a year to do this whole tour, besides recording the album, Victory album, and putting the whole tour together. It was caused by a lot of work.
Well, we wish you a lot of luck with it, and I'm very appreciative to you for joining us this evening. I know you wish you were in Kansas City, and for your sake, I wish you were, too.
Yeah, and also I'd like to say one thing. I'd like to thank all the many fans who sent me all the beautiful balloons and flowers and all the fan mail around the country. I'd like to thank them very, very much for doing that.
Terrific. All right, Jackie, thanks very much for being with us. I'd like to warn our affiliates we're going to be going over just a little bit. I think most of you will want to see what we have coming up next. It's one thing to be a superstar. It's something else to have the music critics take you seriously. When we come back, we will not only see some more of this concert, we'll talk about Michael Jackson's music with veteran rock critic Brian Marcus.
And I can't get sweet love of you. Not a big one. I would my life supposed to be.
His top rock critics has to say about tonight's concert in Kansas City, but before we do that, let's take another taste of the concert itself. Michael Jackson and Human Nature.
New.
She got lost in something beside. She ain't got size. Let me out into the night. Falls won't fall me tonight. And if this town is just an apple, then let me take a bite. If they say why, tell them that it's human nature. Why, does he do it that way? If they say why, tell them that it's human nature. Why, does he do it that way? Reaching out, across the night. Electric eyes are everywhere. See that girl, she knows I'm watching. She likes the way I stare. If they say why, tell them that it's human nature. Why, does he do it that way? If they say why, tell them that it's human nature. Why does she do it that way? I like living this way. I like living this way.
Joining us now, live from Arrowhead Stadium in Kansas City, one of the country's most respected rock music critics, whose name I mangled a moment ago, Greil Marcus, author of the book Mystery Train, Images of American Rock and Roll. Do you have the courage? Is it indeed necessary to say anything bad about this concert, or is it everything that the fans hoped it would be?
I don't know what the fans hoped it would be. What it is a very solid, very well rehearsed, very seriously prepared, good rock and roll show. When the material is wonderful, as it is with Human Nature, the stadium seems to lift a little bit. When the material is pretty standard, like the ballad She's Out of My Life, it's a song. It's a good show. It's not the end of the world. I don't think it's the beginning of the world.
I guess to a Jackson family fan, to a Michael Jackson fan in particular, just being there is enough.
Being there is a lot. When someone has been publicized as much as Michael Jackson has been, when you've seen his face and read about him for so long and so much, just to be in the same space of ground with him and to find out that he's actually real is very exciting. And he knows how to exploit that. He knows how to move, how to lift the crowd, how to respond to their thrill at the fact that he's actually there.
Greil, we have been looking at excerpts from the concert, and of course we have the advantage of those wonderful lenses that put the performer right in your lap, quite literally. A concert like this, when you are sitting 100, 200 feet away, you really have any sense of what's going on? Is the scale large enough?
Well, I was sitting quite a bit more than 100 feet away, and I was very happy with where I was sitting, maybe halfway back. You could see well, you could hear well. There was no need to look at the giant television screen that made everything bigger. That was not the problem. It's a very strange audience for a very standard show. It's perhaps the youngest and the oldest audience I've ever seen at a rock and roll concert. It's a family audience. It's a 4th of July picnic. It's a church social. It's a quiet, placid, sociable crowd. Lots of little kids, lots of people in their 40s and 50s. It's unlike any other rock and roll event I've ever been part of.
When you keep referring to it, however, as a standard show, what do you mean by that?
I mean that it's a set of familiar songs that are set forth in a very familiar way, and there is very little in the music, what I was able to hear, because of course the show is still going on, that I think took expectations beyond where they would have been when the crowd came into the hall. That's basically what I mean.
Greil, I guess it all boils down to one final question. If you're sitting in other cities right now and your kids are saying to you, please, we're talking $30 a crack here, is it worth the $30? Are they getting their entertainment's value?
Well, everyone will have a different answer to that. My answer to that is no. And the reason is, it is a standard rock and roll show. It's a good one. There are many others. They don't cost that much. And I think what really isn't worth it is automatically excluding a very large proportion of the audience that's made Michael Jackson the kind of star, the kind of performer, the kind of artist that he is right now. an enormous number of people were automatically excluded from attending this concert and will continue to be excluded as long as tickets cost such a remarkable amount of money.
Greil Marcus, you're very nice to join us. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
The topic on This Week with David Brinkley on Sunday is the Supreme Court. The guests include former Attorney General Griffin Bell and the Solicitor General of the United States, Rex Lee. That's our report for tonight. I'm Ted Koppel in Washington. For all of us here at ABC News, good night.
Don't you get under, you're stuck in the middle. The pain is stuck there, the high get over. You don't get under.
This has been Nightline, a presentation of ABC News.
And again, it's always talking when my body does this talking.